am nobody.
Oh, yes.
I am a big nobody,
yes,
without the Lord.
Yes.
I am nothing.
Yes.
I was telling the Lord, without you, I fall.
Yes.
Without you, Lord, I fall.
Yes.
I'm scared to be out of the will of the Lord. I'm scared to not have Him with me, His presence. We need the Lord. Saints, there is nothing, bar nothing, that we can do without the Lord. We can do nothing without Him. From the simplest of things, like the functions of our body, and we've talked about it. We can't breathe without Him. We're not in control of our breathing. We think we could, but if something obstructed our airway right now, we would be in a fight for our life. And if it wasn't for the mercy of the Lord, knowing that we were but dust, as He reminded Himself in Psalms, we were but dust. And He looked on us and said, I have mercy on you. He said, I took pity on you. Amen. We can't keep our heart beating. Waking or sleeping, we can't keep our heart beating. We can't keep the rhythm that it takes to pump the right amount of blood to put oxygen through our bodies so we don't become brain dead. We can't make our own heart do that. We need the Lord on every level. On every level. But for life, where would we be without our God? Who would we be? What type of characteristics would we portray? What type of issues would we be in that were swallowing up our minds, even the very thoughts of our existence? Where would we be without our God? We need Him. We need Him for every single day, for every moment in every day. We wouldn't know how to be. We wouldn't know how to act. We wouldn't know the difference of right and wrong. We wouldn't know. There wouldn't be a conviction on the inside to say, man, I feel like I'm living below my standard. What standard would there be? But the Word says that even in those times, He came to lift up the standard. He came to judge and say, no, this is my child whom I'm looking upon. You're meant for greater. You have royal blood flowing through your veins. You are meant for greater. Though you may not understand, our God took His time. He took His time, came down on this earth, and walked just a little bit so that we could look back and have an example to say, if I'm supposed to be a fellow heir with Christ, if I'm supposed to be like my brother, you call me that. If I'm supposed to be like that, it's the only thing we have to measure anything up to. But we of ourselves, I know for me, when I was drowning in the pit of my mind, there was nothing that I could do. There was nothing that I could do to get myself out. Now, here was the thing, I had the judgment to say, wait a second, I don't want to be this way. I don't want to live like this. I don't want to fight with the one that I live with, the ones that I say I love. I don't want to have confrontation to the point of it causing an idea to pop in my mind that should say, get away. I don't want that. I can judge that accordingly and say, wait a second, this don't feel right. But now how? Now how? Though I've put that on the block and said, okay, I don't like that about myself. Now how do I perform in getting out of that mindset? What do I get next? Where do I go? Who can I talk to that can give me an alternate path? Because where I'm at is all I see. And it's like I turn, but then I just see the same path again. How do I get out? And as I found myself in that way, there became another idea in me. And I know the Lord put it there. You need me. You need me. In every path, in every avenue where I said, hey, tired of living this way. That same thought popped up. I need the Lord. I need the Lord. I can't do this. I keep trying to do this. I keep trying to do this. I keep putting my hand to the issue, the situation, and saying, well, you know, the Lord said, well, you've done all you can. And I was trying to use scripture to back it up. And the Lord saying, you got nothing. You got nothing. You got to first give me, and I'll give you what you need. Then when you've done all you can.
Amen.
I couldn't do it of myself. My brain was killing me. It was killing me. Mentally and physically. Killing me. We need the Lord. We need Him. I can't say it enough. We need the Lord. We need Him. It ain't just about physical death. Because, yeah, then we're gone and then we're gone. We're going to wake up somewhere. But while we're here, the Lord said He came to give us life and that more abundantly. I should be having abundant life. I know that before Him, I had none. Before the Lord, I had no life, let alone an abundant life. No way. I had misery after misery after misery. Downfall after downfall. Let down after let down. To a point of just giving up. Forget it. Then just forget it. The throwing in of the towel. Then just forget it. Why am I caring? Why am I even caring that? Just forget it. I'm going to be who I want to be. Then forget it. I'm just going to do then what I want. Forget this. I'm trying to do the right thing that I want. And I'm getting farther and coming. And you know what? Just forget it. And I just don't care. I just don't care. Then forget it. If I feel it, I'm going to do it. If I think it, I'm going to say it. If you don't like it, hey, that's you. Oh, man. It got so much worse. It got so much worse. Then I literally really started destroying the relationships that I had in my life. I really then started being able to witness a hurt that I was inflicting because of my words, because of my actions, because of my ways. Spiraling out of control, moving like a locomotive with no brakes. No brakes. And someone stranded on the railroad track singing, stop, 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 and there's nothing I can do. But God, when Jesus, hallelujah, the Holy One, when the Almighty see me polluting in my blood, when He see me and said, no, I didn't make you to be like that. I didn't create you to live in that mindset. I didn't make you to be brought down because of those thoughts and those emotions. I made you greater. And I made you to be able to hold power. I made you a vessel like I am. I made you spirit. I made you like me in my image. Glory be to the Most High God. We need Him. We need Him. With all that is in the word need, we need Him. You know, when I was thinking on the Lord and how good He really is, you know, in this walk we call salvation, there's so many different things now, and in my mind I'm saying, Lord, I just want to please you. I just want to please you. You saved me from a life that was headed towards damnation. It was literally headed towards no other way but down. And there was nothing I could do to fix it. There was nothing I could do to change it. I could go to counselors. I could go to people that seemed wise in my eyes. I could go to people that seemed successful to the world standards. I could go to my parents. I could go to different places, people, and things. And nobody had the answer. Nobody had for me what it was going to take to get out of that lifestyle. Nobody but Jesus. All paths led to Him. He let every road be a dead end, but only the veering to another path that led straight to Him. Glory be to God. Don't He know how to do it?
Yes.
He would let man let you the road might be very short, but just under 4 years, what a short walk. And Jesus came 33 years, and there was others that lived longer. And I know of some now in late age, old and gray hair, been walking for a long time for the Lord. And I heard a song that somebody sang, he said, I'm not tired yet. I'm not tired. Been walking for the Lord a long time. A long time. And I began to think about all the things that I went through in this walk called salvation. The pitfalls. The places where I thought, man, I've done it now. He's going to throw me away. Hallelujah. He's going to throw me away now. Now I feel him touching me. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. He ain't going to do us like everybody else did us before we met him. He ain't going to crumble us up, though he has every right to. He has every right to because he came and suffered that we may live. And there was times when I took advantage of that. There was times I took advantage of the mercy that he put in my life. And I remember the pitfalls. And you know, in those times I felt so bad. I felt so bad. Like, man, did anything even really change? You know what I'm saying? Did anything even really change? Am I really even saved? How can this be? How can I hurt the one that's loved me so much? The one that put himself out there. The one that took on that pain and that suffering. All out of the graciousness and excitement of saying, I'm going to bring you life. I'm going to bring you life. He was so happy to do it. Yet I found myself in selfish times, knowing better. That's the thing, I knew better. Yet I still found myself in ways of saying, man, Lord, I did it again. I did it again, Lord. I let you down one more time. I heard him so sweetly, so softly, he said, now there's therefore no condemnation. Now there's therefore no condemnation. I don't even remember those times. What are you doing remembering them? What are you doing feeling bad about that for? Don't you remember I came to bring you life? Don't you remember that I came to bring you life more abundantly? With the same smile that he had way back on Calvary. That same smile that he wore on Calvary. Because he knew he was good for us. Oh, glory!
He would literally come into my presence, and as I poured myself out,
It's like he was filling me with love. He was filling me with more love toward him. That when that wedge would show itself, I could say, oh no, there's too much love. And at the same time, as I asked him to put a hatred in me toward that thing, he was dropping it in there. All at the same time. This awesome God that we serve had every single thing that I need. Everything we need, he's got it. No matter what avenue it's in, he's experienced it. He's the overcomer. He is the great I am. He can say, I overcame that. Oh, that I overcame that. He's got every single thing we need. Amen. And as I thought about, man, Lord, you've helped me overcome so many things. I began to think about, you know, there's a song that says, count your blessings. Name them one by one. Count your blessings. See what God has done. Count your blessings. There's so many. We can't, how do we number them? How could we number the blessings? What calculator would we need to sit down and say, okay, well, I remember, even before salvation, those were still faith, those were, that was mercy. Mercy's a blessing. But if it wasn't for mercy, we'd be gone. We would be done. Count your blessings. What did he do? There's so much to this. So I said, you know what? There's so much that happened before salvation. It's crazy. I should have been dead many times over. I should have been taken over. I should have lost everything I had. So I just started to think about in the times from salvation when I gave my life to the Lord. Lord, what have you done? Count my blessings? Are you kidding me? Every moment of every day has been a blessing. But just the simple fact that you've allowed me to get to know you, the little bit that I have, that's a bigger blessing than I could ever ask for any other. And you blessed me with my family. You blessed me with my children. Every one of them different in their own way. You blessed me with a beautiful spouse, a loving spouse. Then I started thinking about even in that one individual, the different blessings of the Lord that have overpoured and I've been affected. That's still a blessing to me, though he blessed one, it was still a blessing to me. They're innumerable, the blessings of the Lord. But in those blessings, he looked down on us and said, no, progress. No, a pushing forth. No, there's no stagnant of staying the same, not in me. Because in God, there's only growth. It's funny, he says, I change not. But he'll change in a heartbeat. And just as we think we've understood how the Lord works, oh no, I know how to seek the Lord. Oh yeah. Then all of a sudden, that don't work no more. And you're like, oh, wait a second. Lord, am I sick? And we're coming right back. Am I worthy? Lord, did I do something wrong? And he's saying, I'm just taking you higher. I was coming in your presence because you didn't know no better, but let's move on to the weightier matters and not leave the elementary things undone. Well, he's a God of growth. He don't let nothing stay the same in him. When we come into him, it's literally upward. Upward. And in my mind, I heard progression to perfection. Progression to perfection. It's a constancy. It's a never ending. It's in every single solitary day. If the first blessing he gave, which was to wake us up in the morning, if that came to pass, and we found our eyes open and we saw our bedroom, and we were still in the same place where we went to sleep, and that when we went to move, we could literally have our functions of our body. If we were clothed in our right mind when we woke up this morning, all those blessings right there, boom, 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 and all we did was just open our eyes. But in that fragment of time, which is called a day, which is due yesterday, hey, 3 days ago, where were you? Oh, so tomorrow, what are you thinking? In that fragment of time that we call a day, there's no downtime in the Lord. He's saying, progression. Progression, it's another day. Okay, I woke you up. Now listen, here's what we gotta do. Next level. Sometimes as man, we think the level is this place so far out. Well, you know, I guess it'll be a couple years until that comes. So until then, I was guilty of being in standby mode. Standby mode. Well, when that time comes, Lord, your will, Lord. So when that time comes, you know, I'm just going to be here. You know, I love you, and I'm just going to be here. I wasn't planning on talking about this. Brother Eric.
He is limitless.
So I got abounding that word. He's limitless. anytime, anywhere, that easy. He's limitless. We serve him. Not only do we serve him, it's though he would say, I'm ruler, you're servant. Yes, it's that way. But then he also said, I'm going to make you fellow heirs with my son, my only begotten. I'm going to bring you into the royal familyhood. And in another place he said, though it be not robbery, that we be equal. Equal how? In those limitless opportunities. Limitless in life. Because he said, I came to bring life and life more abundantly. So in that abundant life, there's a road. There is a road in that abundant life. First of all, his name is Jesus. He said, I am the way. I'm the path. I'm everything you need. I'm the road to where the Father wants you to be. But I heard that progression to perfection. There is a call from heaven. There's a call from heaven for the children of God to be perfect. Perfect. Now when man hears that, when man hears that, first thing man wants to say, well, nothing's perfect. Well, nobody can be perfect. We're here on this earth. That's a lie straight from hell. That lie was to give place to flesh. That lie was to give place to the in the times where it gets a little tough. In the times where we're supposed to press, that lie makes us say, well, nobody can be perfect. I've never even heard anybody say that with joy. Well, you know, nobody can be perfect. It's a joy. Nobody can be perfect. It sounds like a justification whenever I heard it. Do you know, I was raised under that mindset. I was raised in a church under the mindset of, you just got to give your life to the Lord. You just save one time and then it's over. Nobody's perfect. As long as you say, Lord, I know you died on the cross for my sins, and I believe that you did, and I receive you as my Savior in Jesus' name. Congratulations, brother. You're saved. Hey, nobody's perfect. Why am I going through this? Hey, we just don't understand the will of God sometimes, but, you know, nobody's perfect. I'll pray for you. I need help. I don't need no empty words. I need help.
That's right.
You don't understand what's happening inside of me. There's a detonation waiting to take place. I'm exploding. I can't control myself no more. I need help. There's an impending danger I feel coming up on me. It's lurking in the dark and it makes me feel. I need help. You don't understand what's going on inside my mind. I'm scrambling up a wall that's got no handles. It's just a flat wall. I can't see my way out no more. I'm in a tunnel. There's no light where I am. I need help. I needed help. But I thank the Lord for a ministry that he would set to the side to bring out understanding. Not that we're better. He chose. There ain't nothing I did. If it weren't to me, I'd be so crazy, man, I probably wouldn't be going to church at all if it weren't to me. But because the Lord seen fit, he seen otherwise. He seen another path and said, no, come on, get in line, son. Get in line. Amen. There is a call from heaven for the children of God to be perfect. Not was according to man, that what man says perfect, but what God calls perfect. See, the scripture opens up so perfectly and says, our ways are not his ways, neither are our thoughts his thoughts. There is far away is the heaven where he abodes, not where the birds fly. not where the stars reside, but where he abodes. There is far away from there as it is from the earth. Guess what? No man's ever been there before. That's far. That's far. His ways are that far from our ways. There's no understanding unless he gives it. There's no comprehension unless he breaks it down. There's nothing. What could man know? Open your Bible to 1 Corinthians. Amen. It's nothing we did. It's not about who we were to ourselves. It's not about who we were to anybody else. It's about who we were to God. It's about who we were to the Almighty, the great Creator, who marked us from before time began and predestinated us from before the existence of the earth. He said before the foundations, before they were created, he already knew who we were, he already knew what the plan was, and he already knew the course of action. He already knew. Amen? In 1 Corinthians, in chapter 1, we're going to start in 17. Amen. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 17.
For Christ said, me not to baptize.
Hold on, I'm in 2 Corinthians. Oh. All right, this thing, right? Amen.
For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect.
The Lord had come with sweet, swelling words. He didn't come just to tell me everything was going to be all right. He came to live perfection. He came to live out the example of perfection, to literally show us the way of how to do and how to be a pleasure to the Father. Amen? Go ahead.
For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God.
So the Lord came, Jesus, in flesh, Jesus, in spirit, the Christ, power of God inside that man named Jesus, literally killed the ways that were killing me. He murdered them. He murdered them for me. The ways that were killing me, he killed them. He went after them. He was on a mission, literally sent by the Father. It said, these ones who I've set off to the side and marked to be my special favorites, this over here is killing them. Go down there and kill that so they can be free. But he didn't come with sweet, swelling words of wisdom and grandeur. He was simple. He came and said, that's not of God. I'm going to kill it. It was just so simple. And to comprehend that was like, well, what do you mean? Well, what do you mean you gotta die? What are you talking about? Drink of your blood and eat of your flesh. What do you mean? It's around this simple thing that the Father was doing for his own. But to look on the way that we thought it should be, took away from the power that the Lord showed us was in Jesus the Christ. Amen? Go ahead.
For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent.
But all the ones, the doctorates, the ones that have gone to schoolings of high caliber, where people, wow, you have a 4.0 from that book? Man, you really, mom, I feel dumb standing next to you. out. You can't figure me out. Amen? Because he will bring to nothing. Then by the time they're done explaining themselves, the simple things of the Lord are there saying, you sound like a clown. You just talked yourself in a circle. Now you're right back to where you were. You literally contradicted yourself three times. You hear yourself? It's the wisdom of man. Amen? Go ahead.
Where is the wise?
Where is the wise? That's a question. Where is the wise? Well, I like to think of myself to have a pretty good understanding of this. And the Lord's like, oh, really? Oh, teach me something. He's saying, where is the wise? Amen?
Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God, and pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe.
And the first time the good news was expounded, and these ears received that the Lord came to give himself that I may have life, the gospel, the good news, that there's a savior of mankind who loved me more than he loved how much this was talking, that he would override and kill this, that I might live. I never got to shake his hand. I never got to hug him. Never got to look in his eyes and say thank you. From the bottom of my heart, thank you so much. You mean so much to me. Just want to tell you thank you and that I love you. I never once got the opportunity to meet this man. And once, he never saw me in this form, but he loved me enough. He loved me enough that he would come and give himself unto death. Who at any point in time could say, okay, I've had enough. I'm over. No, Father, I'm done. At any point in time. Yet when it got that bad, the peace that came over his mind when he thought of us, in the love that said, no, I'm good. I'm going to stay. I'm going to humble myself unto death. When I heard that good news, blew my mind compared to any of expounding teachings that I ever heard. Amen? Go ahead.
For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness.
So that's how these people were. Before knowing Christ, before salvation, the Jews needed a sign. Well, if you are God, show me a sign. Let this happen by this time. And if it does, then I'll know it's you telling me. How many times we read that? Amen? And the Greeks, they sought after wisdom. All these ones that Paul found when he went over into Greece and Thessalonica, Ephesus, and all the ones that were over there in Mars Hill. And he said, you got this sign, you're serving a God, but you know his name. But they were so wise in bringing it all together, that they were so wise in understanding there's a sun God and a moon God and a God of rain and all these things, their wisdom. Well, what that is. Amen? But Paul was bringing out and said, no, we just bring Christ crucified. That's it. That's all we got. That's all that's going to save. That's all that's going to deliver. Amen. But to the ones that saw the sign, it was a stumbling block to say, well, wait a second. Well, how do we know that? Where's the sign then if he was the Son of God? How? That's why many of them, when they stood at the cross afterward, when the temple was rent, they said, truly, he must have been the Son of God. There was that sign there when he was risen, and that flame went out, that he came back, that he rose on that third day. Truly, he must have been the Son of God. Amen? And unto the Greeks, the Gentiles, that just seemed crazy. You mean to tell me all I gotta do is just believe? That if I believe, that's it. Hang on a second. There's gotta be something deeper. There's gotta be more to this thing. Amen? Go ahead.
For unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God.
Unto the ones, we, that were predestinated, we, the ones that were called, unto us, Christ became the power of God. Christ was the way those mountains were moved in our life. Christ was the way those boulders and hindrances were taken out of the way. Christ was the way that we were illuminated in our mind, because he said, my word is a lamp unto your feet, a light unto your path. It was the way that we said, oh, hold up. This is not good for me. I need to be doing this. How come I never saw this before? Why was I blinded to this? I didn't have Christ. But when I found out that there was a big God, and he could save in a big way, and I heard that gospel preached unto me, and I received those words, and that's the truth. I don't even know how I know, but that's the truth right there. When I received that, boom, there was a change. There was a change. And that effectual change, his name is the Christ. He's the power of God. That's who he became to me. He became wisdom to say, I'm not doing that no more. Oh my God, I can't believe I've done this many years. I'm crazy. I'm never doing that again. Thank you, Jesus. Amen? That's who Christ became. Go ahead.
Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called.
Look around. Look around. And God is no respecter of person. He'll save whom he will. He'll save whom he will. He said he would that nobody perish. He would that nobody died without him. Hell wasn't made for mankind. It was made for demons and Satan. That's who hell was made for. God has mercy. He don't want none of us to die. That's why he made us in his image. But if you're looking around, these chosen, these called, these few, he said, if you read him,
for ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called.
I don't see y'all King Tut sitting in here. I mean, it could happen. I don't see President so-and-so. It could happen. Because nothing is greater than God. It could happen. If he wills it to be so, it's done. But notice when we look around, brothers and sisters, that's who we are. We came from different places. Many of us didn't know each other before salvation. There's little groups of people that knew each other. But look how God called. But as we're all sitting, and as we've been in our picnics, as we've been in our gatherings, which the Lord has blessed and given us wisdom, how to enjoy life, it ain't boring being saved. It was boring being out there. It was boring. There was 1,000 things I could have done, and it was like, well, I've done that. I don't want to go back over there. And even if there was one thing that I was like, yeah, this weekend, it ended like, oh, man, that was a waste. I can't believe that. Oh, I'm on it, man. Y'all, if I wouldn't have done that, would you be in this predicament? Man. But it ain't boring to be saved. Amen. When you got Jesus, you could be anywhere. You could be pumping gas, and he literally just comes into your presence. You look around, people look at you, oh, am I being lost? You're lost. Amen. It ain't boring being saved. But if you're looking around at the ones that were called, as we talk in those areas and in those different situations, we come to learn, wow, we got common? We all grew up the same way. I didn't know that you could. That's amazing. How do we all have the same thing in common? Well, one thing I know. Go ahead, 27.
But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty.
The people whom everybody's seen, who seem to be the castaways, who seem to be the ones that just, we ain't got time. Yeah, I'm sorry, back in line. Yeah, no, ended at 5. I know it's 4:59, but if we don't clean up 5 minutes before, yeah, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to come back next week. Yeah, no, 5. The ones that were pushed out. The ones that were literally just left. Left for dead. Amen? The ones who we couldn't catch a break sometimes with anybody. Man, does anybody care about me? Man. You know what I'm saying? I know I'm not the only one. I'll talk for me though. I'll say
amen.
I was a nothing. Still am. Was a nobody. Still am. But the Christ, but Jesus. But Jesus, in Jesus, I'm somebody. Amen. But without him, I was a nobody. Amen. The world didn't look at me like nothing special. No, they didn't. What can we get out of here today? That's how I was looked at. What can you be used for? Because once that part of you is done, sorry, man, we got no more use for you anymore. Once you dried up, no more juice for you now? Yeah, well, we literally were looking at your position, and basically right now, so what happens is, I'm sorry. Sorry. It hurts me more than you. Sorry. Yeah, I know you've given everything. I know you have. I know you've put forth all that you are. You've sacrificed family. I know. I know you've sacrificed your kids' birthdays. You've sacrificed so many things. You've given of yourself wholeheartedly. Your mind, everything that you are. I know you've given it all. You know what? You've kind of been like a crutch to me. Hey, you've kind of been, I gotta get in here and start doing things myself. You should just go do your own thing. Yeah, this isn't a bad thing. This is a good thing. Wrong way. With what to show for? After years. Nothing. Left destitute of the world. Left with feeling there's no value. There's no value. And if you threw me away, and you threw me away, and you don't want nothing to do with me, pretty sure everybody else is the same. But when the Lord looked at us, he said, I found her. It's in the exact category where I draw my chosen from. That's who I want. Because those ones who think they got something, I'm going to show them my power. I'm going to show them my wisdom. I'm going to show them my riches. And I'm going to show them how we do things. Me, the Father. Me, the Word. Me, the Holy Ghost, us three, the Trinity, we're going to show the world how we perfect. We're going to show the world what we do with your sprouts and throwaways. We're going to show the rest of them what we do with what you call dirt. We're going to show that when you threw away that piece of coal, all that piece of coal needed was a little pressure. All that piece of coal needed was a little heat. And by heat and by pressure, there's a diamond. And we're going to show back the world and present to the world, this is what you threw away. This is what you threw away. One of the most valuable, precious stones known to man. You threw that away. But what you couldn't see, because I discerned to the marrow of the bone, I discerned on the intent of the heart, I seen diamond all along. When you touched it, you got smudged. But when I seen them, I seen glistening crystals of sugary love. That's what I seen when I looked at them. And so I knew all they needed was my touch. All they needed was my touch. They just needed my hand. Put on them, that's all they needed. A little bit of heat, a little bit of pressure. Turn that piece of coal into a diamond. He's so magnificent. He's so awesome, the God that we serve. Totally limitless. bar me out. You can't squeeze me to the last drop. I am that I am. I have no creator. I created you in the likeness of my image. It's not bothering you. There's not no more condemnation. There's no condemnation. Don't feel bad about that. It ain't robbery. Come over here on this side. My diamond, come over on this side. My sparkling jewel, come on this side. So I can show you off to the rest of the world. Amen? Go ahead.
And base things of the world, and things which are despised, hath God chosen. Yea, and things which are not, to bring the things that are.
To bring to naught the things that are, to bring to nothing, to bring to no effect those things which were done unto us, those things done by mighty men, those things done by notable men, those things done by wise men of the world standard, that when the Lord was finished with his creation, that he could bring those things to nothing. In what area? What do you mean? Because the wisdom of the Lord, spoken in a sentence, could demolish a whole books and books of encyclopedias. One sentence from the Bible can just make it look like just nothing. Nothing. That one flick of his hand, just one little, I take it back, he didn't even gotta move. The thought to come in and out of his mind to say, I'm done. I'm done. When people come up against the children of the Most High God, it's dangerous. It's very, very brave. Because they can push to a certain point where you can't even love them out of it. They can push to a certain point where you can't pray them out of it. They can push to a certain point against the children of God that will facetiously say, I'm done. When the Father says, I'm done, no crying, no pleading, no weeping from any man is going to change his mind. That's the kind of God we serve. Who would we fear if he's on our side? Who would we think could bring up an amount of trouble is to say, now what am I going to do? What? Do we know who we are? Do we know whom we serve? Do we know who we call God? More intimately, do we know who we call Savior? Do we know who we call Lover? Because when we get to know him like that, nothing or nothing would separate us. Nothing would come into our mind or our path that would say, now what am I going to do? I don't even know, man. This is too big. Amen? Go ahead.
That no flesh glory in his presence. But of him are ye in, but of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. That according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord.
Anything that we have to say in our life is of good, we know because of where we came from, it's only the Lord. So as he proves us, as he proves himself in us, as he tries us, is to say, there's another part of perfection. There's another part I want to bring you closer to me in. You don't see it yet. You don't know about it yet. But I'm going to bring it to your understanding. I'm going to show you the part. Because I want to shine you up. I want to perfect you just a little bit more. In that, when people say, wow, when did, the only thing we would have to say is, man, I thank the Lord. Before him, we seen a woman today in Walmart. We hadn't seen her in years. And just bumping into her, she couldn't walk away. She couldn't. Do you think it happened for what time is it? Where is it? Why have it? And I'm saying to myself, that's never a person that I would think that would say, maybe I should come. But I have to say, that's not me. That's the Lord. Because before that, I'd be like, I'll get 12 people for weddings tomorrow. I forget 12 people right now. Walk. I still have time because I'm in a hurry. That meant me. But because of the Lord and stuff, the love, hey, get over here. You know what I'm saying? He had a purpose to bring out that conversation. Why? I don't know. I don't know what she's been going through. I don't know what's been going on. I don't. But I know this. She came in one way. Oh, hey. And she left this way. Okay. All right. Well, send me that information. Okay. I'm saying, what she said? That lady was fired up. Just hearing about what the Lord can do, about what he's done for somebody, the possibilities then say, man, he did it for them. I knew them. I knew how they used to be. My goodness. Amen? Go over to Deuteronomy. We've been here before. This is nothing new. But guess what? I like reading the word. I like to read what the Lord says about me. Amen? And I like to know that there's a call from heaven for the children of God to be perfect. And though we may not have come out of perfection, we didn't have to come out of the stock of perfection where we were when he came into our presence. We didn't already have to have certain qualities about us that he would say. And if there was qualities, they were the lowest degree. They were qualities that everybody else shot away and said, I put you on the balance beam, man, and you fell short. I'm sorry, man. Then you try again next life, or again next year. They won't be wore us off. They already wore us off. Truth be told, they wore us off.
That's the truth.
And that was what the Lord said. Awesome. Those are the ones I want. Amen? To know that that's where I was called from. Deuteronomy 7. And we're going to start in verse 6.
For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God.
See how he already seen the diamond? He already seen perfection. Even in the beginning stages when he first called us, he already seen what we could be in him. Go ahead.
The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people.
Nobody but the Lord. Nobody but God the Father himself. He chose us to be a special people. Special means a different category. You got your not so good, you got your mediocre, you got your good, and then you got your excellent, your special, your reserved, your top shelf. Sometimes you will display that to your regular customer. But to those ones you say, hold up, I got something for you. You're going to like this. Amen? It's who we were to the Lord. Go ahead.
To be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth.
Now, he wasn't going to make us that way and then leave us to our own device. Oh, no. He's more wise than that. But he made us that way. He seen who we could be. He said, yup, I'm going to take a little time out of that for my use. For my use. They're going to be special so I can use them. Amen? Go ahead.
The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor chose you, because ye were more in number than any people. For ye were the fewest of all people.
You were the fewest of all people. You were the fewest in quality, the fewest in characteristic. And the Lord said, no, that's exactly who I want. Because in, for me, I can say, in me, I wanted to be somebody. It was like a nagging, like in the back of my mind all the time. Man, I'm supposed to be doing something. Like, big or something. Like, I'm supposed to know somebody, like, important or something, and then, like, when I meet them, that's going to be my breakthrough I've been waiting for. Maybe it's a movie director or something. Maybe I'm going to be a counselor. Like, what if I'm supposed, I can do that, but I'm supposed to be something special or something. Like, I don't want to sound conceited or come off like that, because, you know, I don't know. Never mind. I'm just, forget it. How do you explain what the Lord put in us? It's because we're chosen. Notice how when I just explained exactly what was in me, the in you was like, yeah, yeah. We didn't know each other that part of our life. But there's the resonating thought of, wow, there must really be a God. Because what he did to me, I thought I was solo. I thought I was all by myself in that. Man, I thought I was going crazy. You literally felt like that too? Whew, good to know I'm not the only one. Good to know I'm not the only one. Amen? But because we were the fewest, the castaways, he said, yup, those were the ones I wanted. And if you talk amongst yourself, you're going to find out you got something in common. Amen? Go ahead.
But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand, and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God.
That's an understanding that we are to come to. Know therefore. Come to this conclusion now. Be settled in your mind and keep in the forefront of your awareness. Keep in the back of your mind and keep on both sides of your understanding. Let it surround you that you know, that you know, that you know. The Lord, he is God. Amen? He is God. The one that called you out. He is God. Amen?
Flesh and blood did not reveal that to you, but your Father was using that.
In that time, the peak of everything you were gunning for your whole life, it all amounted to that one moment, and that was when the Lord showed up. That's amazing. But that's how much love he has. That he ain't shy or embarrassed to show up at any point in time. We become embarrassed because we're in the thick of our dirt. And he's like, hey, how's it going? And we're like,
faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy with them that love him, and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations.
Amen. And the awesome God we serve. He keepeth his covenant. He don't ever go back on his word. He don't ever have to go back and say, well, you know, my bad, man. You made me so mad, you know? He never has to go back and recorrect and fix. He made that covenant. He said, no, now I'm going to bend your path towards me, and the rest that's left, those crooked ways, I'm going to make them straight. I'm going to make them straight, and you're going to be on a one-way path straight to me. Amen? And in that time, the Lord was calling us for perfection. This whole time, he was calling us for perfection. And we can go, not that we could do it ourselves, not that anything we have amounted to something worth. Lord, I'll give you this. Will that buy that away? No, you got nothing on mine. The only thing you got is the life that I gave you. You give that to me, and watch what I do. I created you. You give your being back to me, the Creator, I'll finish what I started. And I'll prove, not only to you, but bigger than you, I'll prove to all those around you, to give you away, and to the ones that were like you, that are being thrown away, I'll prove to them there's a God. I'll prove, amen? I'll use you to prove that I'm real. How great is that? And all along the way, I'm just going to keep blessing you. All along the way, I'm going to keep raising you up closer to me. You'll never get too close. All along the way, I'll just keep bringing you until you're risen fully in that glorified body, just like our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen? As he lived it and perfected, the inner perfected and overcame that outer shell, perfected his walk. He was deemed worthy enough to be raised back into a glorified body. Now there was no more choking inside this. Now there was no more wrestling. Oh, what a day that's going to be. Oh, man. Well, there's no more inner talking or turmoil arising. What a day that's going to be to step up in a glorified body and just feel peace, joy, love, power all at the same time of every waking moment, never being tired in that ever, if you've ever been praising the Lord and you got lost in his presence, that it can be that 24/7, just praising the Father in that glory. Amen? That's where we're headed. Where we're headed in this perfection process. In the speed bumpy road sometimes it feels like. And these hindrances that pop up that, man, I wasn't expecting this. Why did that happen? And as the Lord broke down the wisdom, well, man, don't try to figure that out. Don't do it. Just come back to me. Resort back. Resort back to your rest. Resort. They call them resorts for a reason. Come back to your rest. Let me do it. Let me do it. Amen? Go to Matthew 5. Thank you, Jesus. You know what's amazing is we couldn't even have thought of a life this good for ourselves. You know this God gave us. We couldn't even have thought of these kind of promises for us. You, Aladdin, you got three wishes, buddy. What do you want? Let me see. You couldn't even have thought of these kind of blessings that the Lord. That's why he says it hasn't even entered into your mind. What I have in store for them who love me, it hasn't even entered into your mind. You can't conjure up the blessings. I see this road to perfection. Keep progression to perfection. Amen? In 5, we're going to read the very last verse, 48. One verse.
Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which in heaven is perfect.
That was a command. Those words are a record. That was spoken of by Jesus the Christ, the Son of the Most High God, in flesh form, spoke this. He said, be ye therefore perfect. That was a command. Then he compared us. He couldn't just stop there. Be therefore perfect. He also went on to say, action as of the Father? Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to figure it out. His ways are greater than our ways. His ways are greater than our ways. Remember, He is God. He can do all things. Jesus spoke. Jesus, words and bread of Christ, spoke. I can do nothing of myself. I can do nothing of myself unless it's given of my Father. He does the work. Though that we put in our part, yes, we do. We don't just sit back. It says we're workers together with God. He ain't workers with us like we got a plan. There's no blueprint I had. I wasn't going nowhere and drawing up a design. This is what I'm going to do. Not every Friday. No, there was no plan I had. But I'm a worker together with Him. With Him. Amen? Because the first time I had that encounter with the one called Christ, I understood in that was my power. Therein lied my power. Therein lied my wisdom. That's where I derived the way out of Christ, the power of God. Now I know, Lord, You've been calling me to You this whole time because You were the one that had what I needed to get closer to You so that I could be like You, so that I could put away all of this and be glorified unto You, to be used by You for Your glory. Amen? First Corinthians, chapter 11. Turn over there if you would. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. First Corinthians, chapter 11. Verse 31.
For if we judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world.
Amen. So it wasn't of anything that we could do ourselves. It wasn't a way that we knew. Because if we were to judge a situation, we wouldn't be judged. Amen. Read that again.
For if we judge, if we would judge ourselves.
If we would judge ourselves? Hold on, what's going on here? Well, this is what happened. I came in the room, and if we would judge ourselves in our situations that we were in at that point in our life, if we were to judge ourselves,
we should not be judged.
Then we wouldn't be judged. Because we wouldn't be fair. We wouldn't be fair on two accounts. The first account, we wouldn't be fair because what was in me at the time was selfishness. I would not have been fair. I would have said, no, you did me wrong. No, that's what I'm talking about. If you didn't say that, I wouldn't have hit you. What? It's his fault that you hit him? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. If you never would have went there, then I never would have done what I did. I told you not to do it, and you did it. Well, there you go. Well, no, I didn't want to be that way. I didn't want to do that, but there's me not judging me, because I'm saying, but I'm making a way for it to be the way that it is. So if the Lord said, wait, if I left perfecting up to you, you would never get there. You would stay where you always have been. And the last time I counted everything up, you were sad. The last time I saw everything and put it on the balance beam, you don't have joy. And now I know I created you for joy. I know I made you to have peace. And I sure know I made you to hold power. So when I look on you as my beloved, my predestinated chosen, well, I didn't find love. But then I didn't find power, and I didn't see no joy. So then I had to judge the matter and say, wait a second, what's going on here? Something don't seem to be right. Because this is why I created it, and if it's not that way, well, I'm the only righteous judge. I'm going to go figure out why it's not that way. We couldn't do that. I know for me, I couldn't. See, See, he don't judge to condemn. Condemn to damnation. He don't judge to bring out a string of evidence. This is what man does. I used to be really good at this. Bringing out a string of evidence so finely put that it drew the picture to get to a climax of this,
I guess I did.
So you did do it. So you were there at the 5:5. That's what I was trying to say. To aha moment of saying, judge. Judgment. See, I told you. God don't judge us in that fashion. He don't judge us to condemn us to damnation. He's judging on this wise. Wait a second. I know I made them for power. But now when I look at them, I'm not finding power. So, okay, so where's the hold up here? Now let me figure it. Okay, I think he's got to figure nothing out. He already knows. Oh, I don't see me in them. Oh, that's what it is. That my power, the Christ, it's not in them yet. Why the word says that he sent the spirit of his son into our heart, crying, Father, Father, send the Christ. Father, please, send the power to overcome. Father, please, send the wisdom to progress forward in this walk. Father, please. So when the Lord judged, he said, that's it. My Christ isn't there. Okay? Let's make a way for the Christ to be in your heart. See why he judged? And see how he judged? It was a positive thing. It wasn't never to make us feel bad as if like, yeah, why are you on? What's new? It wasn't that. It was for him to say, I judge the matter to be. You're not where you're supposed to be. Now I'm going to make a way to get you there. I want to be judged. I don't know about you, brothers and sisters, but I want to be judged now. Because there's one chance we get, and it's while we're in this carcass. That's it. Because after this, the judgment. And at the final judgment, nope, I came to you this time, and this time. I begged to put my power in you. I pleaded over and over. I wept. I wept to bring it to perfection. Or, well done. Thou good and faithful. Every time I showed you where you could get closer to me, you ran. You literally ran to that power. You ran to that wisdom. You ran to your healing. And because of that, you get to spend eternity with me. Enter in. Enter into your rest. Amen. That's why he judges. That's why he judges. I want to be judged now. If there's anything in my path that's hindering me from coming to a full perfection in the Lord, I want to know about it. I can only know if I'm judged. I can only know if I'm on the examination table. Amen? In that perfection, progression to perfection. Perfection is the act of perfecting. And I didn't know this. I just wrote down what came to my mind, and as I'm looking, the Lord said, study that. What is perfection? Well, I thought that I knew, but as I read it, it's the act of perfection, or of perfecting. It's in the act, meaning there's action. It literally took somebody to understand, oh, okay, so I'm here, but you want me there, so you're going to give me the power to get there, so I just got to go. Okay, I'm taking action to get to that place where he's called. Me too, amen? So perfection is the act of perfecting. Those all come from the word perfect. Perfect means complete in all respects. Flawless. You know the top-notch diamond you can ever buy? It's called a flawless diamond. They're the most expensive, they're the most rare, and they don't keep them in the front case. That's the one they go in the back to get. They hide it away where? In a special place. Go to a jewelry store next time they see a flawless diamond. You're going to see them walk to the back. And when they bring it out, you may not know what you're looking for, because to us, a diamond is sparkly, it refracts the light. We see, But when they go like this and put that little thing on, and they look up close, no, there's cloudiness in there. Yep, there's impurities. That's what a jeweler sees when they put on that. the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the earth, seeing the evil and the good. Mm-hmm. And for his chosen, saying, oh, I want to perfect him there. Oh, I want to bring him closer to me there. Oh, I want to make him more flawless in me. I want to make him flawless. Right. I want that when I finally present them, when Jesus presents us to the Father, when the da-da-da-da, and when he finally presents us, the Father says, flawless. I see no cloudiness. I see no chips on the inside that when pressure comes might fall apart. Amen? That's an amazing God that we serve. They talk about, as Santos, his brother Santos, was bringing out on Sunday, Jesus is the cheat codes. The cheat codes to perfection. The cheat codes to say, I'm going to give you exactly what it is. I've called you out. I've told you where I wanted to be. Now I'm going to give you everything you need to get there. Okay, ready? That is amazing. That's almost not even fair. That's amazing. Amen? Progression to perfection. And that progression is the progress of developing or moving gradually towards a more advanced state. The process of developing, process right away tells me it didn't happen overnight. Process tells me right away that there were certain procedures that had to take place, process, and they had to be in order for the process to work. Or moving gradually toward a more advanced state. That tells me progression has levels to it. That tells me that as I'm moving forward, I'm also moving up. There's progression. And the Lord said, now study that word progression again. Because I saw progression as just up one line. And he said, no, it's not. It's not just a forward motion. It's up. There's progression. Then I thought of a music scale, put it in my mind, the music scale. That's progression. I said, whoa, whoa. So as I seen that, as I started getting the other way, it's a succession or a series. It's a series. And I never heard this word a day in my life. Concatenation. Concatenation. C-O-N-C-A-T-E-N. A-T-I-O-N, a series of interconnected events. Series meaning they came one after the other. They were interconnected. Man, this is just like the... They all seemed to take place, but they were leading to the same common goal. And every time I came to the beginning and the end of an issue, there was the Lord bringing me into one, perfecting me, then making a way for me to get out of that. Amen? All leading closer to him. Progression to perfection. And him saying, no, I'm not done. I am not done. Man says, oh, you're doing a great job. Yeah, I've been watching you, man. I'll tell you what, I know the Lord's in you. And the Father's looking and saying, I'm not done. They're not looking with my eye. I see deeper. There's more blessing I have for you. There's greater than I have. There's areas you don't see that. You don't know are there. I'm going to bring them out and expose them. Now there's therefore now no condemnation. Don't die. But progress. Know that it's me saying, okay, I've chosen this area for you to closer to me, more like me, though it's me, not robbery. Don't think it's like robbery, but I'm going to bring you to this perfection. I want to bring you to this greatness. Amen? That's an amazing thought for man to comprehend. That's an amazing thought for us to think that we serve a God that his soul and the whole reason he came into our life was to make us better, to make us more like him. You don't find that in the world. The world don't do that. The world brings you in because you got something to offer. And then you're used based on something which you have to offer. Then if they find out there's another thing you can offer, well, that was just a bonus. You can hang out a little longer. But once you can't offer that no more, once you've been used up and dried up, or you ain't putting forth the same, yeah, we're going to have to part ways. It's not you, it's me. You're right. You're not being satisfied like you were before. It's not you, it's me. You're right, it is you. But we have a Lord. We have a governor over all creation that chose us out of the pack, chose us out of the group, and said, I'm going to make you just like me. I'm going to perfect you. I'm going to perfect you in all areas. Perfect, complete in all aspects. In all aspects. That means every avenue. Every single avenue of our life. Every avenue, the love avenue. He's going to perfect us there. The peace avenue. Hallelujah. He's going to perfect us there. The joy avenue. He's going to perfect us there. The wisdom avenue. He's going to perfect us there. The humility avenue. He is going to perfect us there. The giving over of ourself. He's going to perfect us there. In every avenue, he's going to perfect us so that it slides so smoothly into him. Amen? I love the Lord. I love him so much. Because I know I wasn't worthy of this. I know I wasn't worthy to be called to something this good. But he saw me fit. Of all the ones that I knew in my life growing up, who I could think, nah, they should get it over me. Because they did these things and those things. I never amounted to that. I schemed and connived. The Lord said, no, you were the one I found worthy. You were the one I wanted this whole time. This whole time, you fit right into my perfect plan. There's so much glory we have to give the Lord. There's so much praise. Now I know why David said that his praise was continually in his mouth. That after one praise, another one just welled up. Because there was no end of just how good he is. And how good he was. And how good he's going to be. Amen. You know, the Lord, as I was looking at it, I said, man, Lord, I never had a way. I never had a way. I'm so grateful that you became that way for me. And all these things that I had in my mind that I wanted for my life, it's amazing the Lord brought us all to the same place in the beginning. The first thing he told us was, see ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Seek him first. Seek him and his righteousness, and all those other things, don't even worry about them. They won't even amount to the greatness that he'll put in you. Just seeking after him. Amen? But if we go to Romans chapter 6, in this road to perfection, this progression to perfection, there's some things that are required of us. Amen? Read 3 to the 11th.
Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ,
as we sought first the kingdom and his righteousness, Lord, what is it that would please you? Lord, what can I do for you today? I know I'm no good. Lord, I know I'm not worthy. I'm a righteous dung. Anything I've ever did that looked to be good was filthy rags compared to you. I'm nobody, Lord. But I want to be somebody in you. I want to be somebody for you, Lord, and I need you. As I sought you first, amen? As I was baptized into you, as I was dipped into you, into your spirit, as you allowed me the access into your spirit, as you allowed your spirit access into me, where I finally understood, wow, the Lord has really touched me. There was a difference inside of me. I'm telling you, he's real. I felt him when he touched me. I felt his presence right next to me. I'm telling you, my inner man, my spirit, for witness of his spirit. He's real. Has he allowed us? Has he allowed us to understand? Go ahead.
We're baptized into his death.
We're also, he allowed us into the place where perfection lies. Baptized, dipped into his death. The dying of what we lived in. The mind of the flesh, carnality. But the death of that was going to bring forth life, was going to bring forth perfection. So as he allowed us the access to know who he was, he allowed us the access, the avenue to perfection. Amen? Go ahead.
Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death.
Mm-hmm.
That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection.
So just like Christ condemned sin in the flesh, so we will also condemn the thing that was beaten up on us, the thing that was literally shoving us and bullying us around. He said, no, you're going to walk my footsteps. I'm going to allow you access into the power that can now push back. Where you got beat up, I'm going to allow you access into power where now we can do the beating up. Amen? You ain't getting bullied no more. You're a son of the Most High God. See, no one just told you who you were quite yet. But see, now I've come that you may have life. I've come that you may have life more abundantly, that you may have access into the wisdom of who I am and who you are in me. Amen? Go ahead.
Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin.
No more getting pushed around. No more in the dungeon. Amen? No more living under a standard, but to be resurrected, to be brought up, progression to perfection, to be resurrected, just how Jesus was. Amen? Spiritually resurrected. We are now have access into that. Amen? Go ahead.
For he that is dead is free from sin. Now if we be dead in Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ being raised from the dead dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. Likewise reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
In that road, that pathway, in that progression to perfection, having the understanding in us, we don't live no more to sin. You know, the Lord says, when you sin, repent quickly. He knows along that road, it's a process. It didn't happen overnight. The decision happened overnight. I'm going to serve the Lord. I'm not going back no more. The decision happened, but the process, the progression to it. See, there was too many times where I came to a place where I thought, because I've been shown by the Lord, this is what I don't like about you. Then my mind would automatically go hook myself back to the beginning where he first found me. I'm a sinner going to hell. I'm done. See, this is why, man. I fell at everything else. I've been trying so hard at this. This thing I really did want. I really did want this. I thought for the first time in my life, and I heard him say, now, remember, to those who are in Christ Jesus, now, there's no more condemnation. Don't go back to that. That's not what I'm telling you. I'm showing you where you can be closer to me. I'm showing you how to be more like me. I'm giving you another road. excited. Don't get sad. Don't get sad because now you can reckon yourself to be dead to that sin. You know why you know you're dead to the sin? Because the first thing we say is, I don't even like that. I don't even want that. I feel bad for what I even did. I feel bad for what I even said. I hate that. Oh, I hate that. And the longer you dwell on the separation between you and the Lord, the more it gets stirred up and you're like, Lord, I don't want to be like this anymore. Lord, I don't want it. The crying out begins to happen. In that, the Lord says, you're choosing me over it. You're not going back to it. You're choosing me over it. I just chose today to put a magnifying glass on what was there that you didn't see. Because your eye is not my eye, but I saw it. And it was just a little separation. But see, when there's a crack, if there's a crack of any size, a wedge can get put in that crack. And if that wedge gets hammered, it causes a fracture, a breaking to take place. And the Lord's saying, no, you were separated from me once before. I'm not going to let that happen again. I see a tiny crack, fill it in. Put Christ there, put Christ in it. Fill in the crack. Take the power of God, take the wisdom that I've given. Seek after me, cry out unto me. You're choosing me over it. You're getting me excited, I'm about to move. You're choosing me over it. That's what's taking place. There's no feeling bad that comes with that. There's an excitement that comes with that that says, I'm literally getting out. I'm getting out of the hole that I was in. Lord, you're revealing another rung in the ladder. I never saw that there. Just take your hand, son, and put it there. Now, 20 years, you feel that power coming? Oh, now look, you can see a whole other plateau. You're progressing in me. See the plan of the Father this whole time. This whole time, there is a call from heaven for the children of God to be perfect. There's a call. In these last days and times, there is a call for the children of God to be manifested unto the world. That the Father can say, these special few that I put in the back, these special few whom nobody knew, they threw away, I've been dealing with their heart. I've been dealing with their mind. I've been adding unto them out of my resources. They're in my treasure chest. They're in my toolbox. I've been adding unto them of my spirit. I've been adding unto them of my power. I've been adding unto them of my wisdom, of my love, of my peace, of my joy. And it's getting to be the time where things are moving and I want to start showing them off to the world. I want to open up my treasure chest that I've kept away because I've been building up and I've been perfecting and I've been shining and I've been rubbing off rough edges and making smooth so it can reflect more light, more Jesus. Can just reflect more Jesus. And it's time that I want to take the lid off that treasure chest and I want to start showing off my pieces. This is a family heirloom. This was handed down. You like that? That's called rare stone. You don't find things like, oh, look at this one. Yes. See the young family? Yes, I've been, yeah, I know you've never seen nothing like that. See this? This is me as is. Oh, I know you've never seen nothing like, no, you can't touch that. No, you can't. These are mine. These are mine. Look at this. These are all the same Espinals, but they're different. Look at how this one shines in them. Like, see this color? That's what you can't find that color in that stone. Huh? He wants to show us off. He ain't going to show off nothing less than perfect.
Amen.
Ooh, he ain't going to show off nothing less than greatness. He ain't going to show off nothing less than is what is him. Though it be not robbery, I want you to be like me so that when I show you off the people, whoa, that what they hear out of your mouth is, man, ain't the Lord good? I didn't do this to me. You like it? You can have it too. I didn't. He did it all. Yes, he did. I'm telling you, it's him all day long. It's him. Yeah, but I heard you were going through some crazy stuff. He brought me out. He made a way. He made a way. I just trusted him. All I did was trust him. That's it. And all I did was. was trying to know him more. You mean to tell me, in wisdom of man speaking, you mean to tell me all you tried to do was learn him more, and that happened to you? Yeah, pretty much. I don't know how else to say it. That's it.
Amen.
He does it. He does the work. Amen. But he's getting ready. He's getting ready to open up that treasure chest. Amen. There's a call from heaven for the children of God to be perfect. To be perfect. Amen. Go to 2 Timothy. Because sometimes these troubles, sometimes they can be a little heavy. I'm talking from experience. I ain't trying to preach at you. I'm not trying to teach you nothing. I'm telling you from me. Sometimes these things get a little weighty. Sometimes it looks like the bottom fell out and there ain't no end. It's an abyss and I'm free falling. And I don't know what to do. I'm gaining speed and I feel like I'm headed towards something really fast. And when I hit, ain't gonna be pretty. That's what it looks like. Is sometimes I'm out of the way of help. That's what it looks like. That I've reached out to every single avenue that I was supposed to reach out to. I've held on to every single resource. I've done my diligence. I've studied. I've literally talked to people. I've shamed myself. I put my laundry out there. I've literally just done whatever it took. I came to a mindset of whatever it takes. Because I don't want to fall. I don't want to fall. I'm not giving up on the Lord. I'm not going back. I don't care what it looks like. I'm not going back. And it's in those times right there. 2 Timothy chapter 1. It's in those times that our God says, stand back and let me show you who I am. Stand back and let me be who I am. Because I am that I am. I am Jehovah. I am the Almighty. I am the great creator. I'm the one that make a way out of no way. Stand back and let me. Stand back and let me in these times. Let me do the perfecting. Let me show you, amen, the path. 2 Timothy 1 and verse 12.
For the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed.
We got to have it concreted in our heart. We got to know who we believe. The word says, he who comes to God must first believe. We got to know who we believe. We gotta know who he is. He's the creator of mankind and everything in it. He's the creator of the worlds. He's the creator of all things in heaven and in the earth and things under the earth. And who created him? He is that he is. We gotta believe. We gotta know who we believe. Amen? We gotta know who is, that nothing's impossible. He impregnated a virgin who'll never know a man to bring forth the Savior of man. Who can do that but our God? We gotta know who we believe.
Read. And am persuaded,
fully convinced,
that he is able that which I have committed unto him against that day.
To keep that which I committed. I didn't have nothing to give. I didn't have nothing of value. We didn't have nothing of worth, saints. But the only one thing we had that he even wanted was us. Our heart, our love, our mind, our body, our spirit, our soul. He said, you give you to me like you've given yourself to me.
committed unto him.
To keep that which I committed. I committed myself. I committed myself unto him. That's all I had to give. And look at the confidence he gives us back. I'm able to keep that which you gave me. I'm able to keep it from being fouled up, from being scuffed up, from being battered up, from being flawed and marred back into what I've already brought out from to this level of perfection and progressing in perfection. I'm able to keep right there so we don't do this, but I'm able to keep in one day against that day of perfecting, against that day of trouble, when we seem to find ourselves short. Day late, the dollar short. You heard that? Oh no, that was yesterday. What? I thought it was today. No, you missed out selling it at midnight last night. Yeah, it was only $20. I only got 19 anyway. I wouldn't even have been able to got it. Talk about being let down. Day late, the dollar short. When we find ourselves in those predicaments, then there just ain't no way. Cut it any way you want. Slice it up any way you want. Talk to who you want. And it ain't no way. It ain't gonna happen. Sorry, bro, I don't know what to tell you. It's in those moments that he says, I'm able to keep you. I'm able to keep you against this day right here. Against this day when money ran out. Against this day when loved ones turned their back on you. Against this day when they mind about you. When you know you didn't do it. Against this day when the kings of the earth came down and the judges of the earth came against. Against this day when we had no help. This day I'm able to keep you. I'm able to keep you. So that as you see where there was a lacking, and as I show up with what it is and you receive, that we can keep the progression. And we didn't waste no time. We didn't lose no ground. I'm able to keep you in that day. That's only God. Ain't no man ever been able to keep me. That's only God. Man will say, hey, I got you covered. And you know what happens when the rugs pull out from under him? You're on your own, partner. You're on your own. I don't expect me. You see what I'm going to do? Hey, I don't know what you're going to do. This is what I'm going to do. Come along if you want. The Lord will never leave. He'll never forsake. He's able to keep us from falling. Amen? Because his ultimate destination for us is that perfection. That perfection. On what level? It's infinite. We can never say in God, I've arrived. Whoa. I've arrived. We see our own pastor. The Lord uses him mightily. Ain't nothing he did. It's the Lord using him. We see him go through things that I'm like, Pastor, are you okay? That's my concern. That's me being concerned. That's even in my flesh saying, how's he going to do this one? This one ain't like the last one. Pastor, are you okay? Hey, ain't nothing the Lord can't handle. You always say that, Pastor, but that's not it for real. I literally watch the Lord provide. And I'm not there. So if the Lord has brought him there to this level, I know I can get there. And guess what? You hear our pastor say, I'm a drop in a bucket. I ain't obtained nothing. The Lord's still whooping me and showing me where I gotta get to the next level. So if he's saying that, that means there's other levels of perfection we can attain to. But here's the amazing thing of the Lord. He don't have a finish line where this is where we start and this is where we finish. And if you didn't get there by the time the whistle blew, oh, I know you ran, but you lost. He's saying, to this point, what you've been given, you're held accountable to, and up until this point, you're perfect. My son, my daughter, till this point, you're perfect. But then he went and backed it up and said, but now, let's move on to the weightier matters. And don't leave the elementary things undone. Don't leave the things undone of the perfection that you've gotten this far. But I have greater use for you. There's more I require of thee. There's more that I have. It hasn't even entered into your mind the way that I want to bless you. But there's a little thing that's in between me and you. Here it is. Lord, I didn't even see that like that. I know. Now there's therefore now no condemnation. Don't go back. Remember, this is how I'm bringing you closer. Get rid of this. And how exciting is it now to know you're more like me in that area? Amen? Progression to perfection. On what level? Any level, every level. Till we get to God. It don't ever stop. As long as He gives us breath in this body, there's levels of perfection. Listen, Enoch, thank you, Lord. Enoch was so perfect, the Lord called him no earthly good. No earthly good. He looked at the earth and looked at Enoch and said, no, there's a no, you're too good. Come up here with me. He translated them just like that. And they were like, yo, have you seen Enoch? No, man, I haven't seen him. Where'd he go? I don't know. He didn't leave us a note or nothing. Did he tell you? Well, you guys know we live with him. We woke up from where he was gone. The Lord took him in the body, same as he did Elijah. Took him. So then we say, what level of perfection? Let's just strive. Who can? Who knows? I press toward the mark, Paul said. I press toward the mark of a high calling. There's greater. There's greater. There is greater. The Lord's saying, don't limit me. Don't limit me no more. Don't let your mind conceive an outcome. Don't let your mind take A and B and say, now, if this happens and we can get these two stars to align, man, my way's going to be glorious. He's saying, my way for you was so much better. Don't lower the standard. Just let me do what I know how to do. Perfect you. That's it. Amen? That type of infancy is amazing. Infinite perfection. That's what we've been called to. Levels of greatness that can't be numbered. Amen? For what? For His purpose. For His purpose. All I know is this. The more of Him that's in us, the more powerful we are. The more of Him that's in us, the more holy we are. The more of Him that's in us, the more righteous. You know what righteousness is? Doing the right thing at the right time. 10 out of 10 times. That's perfect. The more of Him that's in us, the more glory is to be revealed. Not that it is us, it's Him in us. It's Him doing the work. But He's saying, don't limit my power. Don't limit my perfectness that I want to put in you for a work that's to be done to show myself off in you in these last days. Don't limit my wisdom, because I'm beyond figuring out, and it's beyond any wisdom you've ever heard of man. That's foolishness compared to my simplicity. My wisdom, you can't comprehend, but I want to put it in you. I want to put it in you. So when man says, how do you know that? You only have one thing to say. Isn't God good? Jesus. He's the way, the truth, and the life. He's the reason I'm at this juncture. And guess what? I'm going higher. I'm going higher. You see me in 6 months today, you ain't going to recognize who I am. Because I'm going higher. I ain't going to stay the same. As long as He gives me breath in this body, I'm going higher. I'm going to take closer to Him. Closer to Him I strive, closer to Him to be. Amen? Philippians chapter 3. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness. Philippians 3 and verse 9. Read to the 14.
And be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him.
See how we get closer? It's not what we do. It's not by our righteousness, but it's what we find in him. When you find me, that's where you'll find me. You gotta say that for yourself. If life just so happens to take a course when you don't cross paths for 6 months, when you see me in him, this is where you're gonna find me. On another level to him. Amen? That why, first time?
That I may know him in the power of his resurrection.
That on every level of my perfecting, that I may be closer to him. Amen? This is what's happening to you in the perfection process. That on every level where he shows you, this is a little piece that's holding me back from being closer to you. And in that when you say, no, Lord, if I just want you, you're doing it. You're choosing me over it. You're doing it. You're overcoming. Here's power. Here's Christ. Now overcome. Kill that thing. Kill it. Now it's dead. Now you're closer to me here. And now you've felt. You've experienced the power of my resurrection. Remember in Romans 6, where he said, as he raised up Jesus Christ from the dead, that we were going to be the same? That in that time is where we experience the power of his resurrection. I used to be dead because of that thing, but now I'm putting off that dead work, and you're giving me the power to move forward in you, and I'm being resurrected closer to you. Amen? Go ahead.
And the fellowship of his sufferings.
See, it's in the troubles. It's in the troubles that we fellowship. Fellowship, hanging out, having likeness, conversations of, I know you too, and isn't it going to feel the same way? You're fellowshipping. See where we get to be close to him? It's in the trouble times. Because those are the times that are being, where we're literally being perfected, drawn closer to him. Amen, go ahead.
Being made formable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I apprehended of Christ Jesus.
I am apprehended. He's saying that I may apprehend, that I may apprehend, that I may get, which also I am apprehended of. And the Lord's getting us just as we're getting him. And when that's removed out of the way, those things, the Lord's saying, I'm getting more of you. He's getting excited because we're more pure of us, who he made us to be, because he's in us now. We're more righteous. It's more who we're supposed to be, how he designed us, who we were supposed to be. He's saying, good. Now that that's out of the way, when I hug you, I don't feel your phone in your pocket. There's nothing in between me and you. I'm just feeling you. I'm getting closer to you. As we're saying, wow, Lord, you're drawing me closer to you. It's a mutual, that fellowshipping. When those things are removed and the perfection process is taking place, we're getting closer to him, and he's also getting closer to us. He's getting more excited. Amen? Go ahead.
Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do.
This is so important right here.
Forgetting those things which are behind.
Put it out of his mind. Forget it like it never even happened. There's therefore now no condemnation. Stop thinking about that. Forgetting those things which are behind.
And reaching forth unto those things which are before.
See the progression? Reaching forth. I forget those things that are behind. So if I'm not paying attention to them, I don't see them. They won't hold me back. But if I look towards, and I go ahead.
I press toward the mark.
If I press, means I'm pushing, means if my my focus is only on those things before me and I'm pressing, I'm going one way and not the other. Amen? Go ahead.
Toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus.
The prize. To be found in Him. The prize. To be counted and deemed worthy by the Most High God. Skip down to 20 and 21.
For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ.
And that's a little cookie he's given to say, and to state, to keep yourself pressing toward that mark, to keep your awareness focused on where you're supposed to be going. What did he say in 20?
For our conversation is in heaven.
Our conversation. What we talk about. Who we talk about. Man, I'll tell you, the Lord is so good. Yo, listen to what he did. And our conversation is there. So where's our mind? Where's our psyche? Where's what we're striving after? Because it's in our mouth, it's there. It's pressing toward that mark. Man, I love him. He's just too good. I want to be like him. I want to love like him. Believe he loves me that way. Man, when I thought I was no good, I felt so bad. That's when he hugged me harder. Yo, we came in, I don't go there, but let me tell you, man, he's so good. Because my conversation is on him, then my mind is on him. And then when I go to do something, I just keep thinking about him. So I say, man, everything I do, I want to do heartily unto the Lord. And just everything snowballs in that direction. Amen? Go ahead.
From whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself.
See how we don't do it? He does it. Unto what? Like unto his glory, that it may be fashioned. Our perfection may be fashioned like unto his glorified body, that we may be found worthy to apprehend the same thing like he got. Do you see that? According to the working, we're workers together with God, according to the working whereby he is able. He is able. He's a way maker. And inside that way, he's like, oh yeah, by the way, here's power. Let's go overcome. He's able. Oh yeah, by the way, I never thought there was no way out of this. Here's wisdom. I never thought about this before. Wow, this makes so much sense. You know what I'm going to do? Yo, how did you do that? Mom, I'm telling you, the Lord gave it to me. Last minute, too, I thought I was a goner. Then his increased faith. Look at his mercy. Now he's saying, do you believe me anymore? Wow, Lord, I'm so sorry. I believe you so much. Man, you didn't have to do that way. Now I'm a righteous God, Lord. Now I'm seeking after him more. And he's saying, man, look at now we're closer. Isn't this exciting? There's so much more I want to give you. You don't even get it yet. All right, let's keep moving on. Perfect this now. And there's an excitement. There's a joy process taking place between myself, between yourself, and the Lord, God Almighty, Jesus the Christ. Amen? Yeah. Am I the only excited one? Maybe it's late or something? I don't know. I didn't drink coffee before I came. I'm excited about the Lord. I don't know. I'm excited to know that I could be made perfect. I was a bum. I don't think you understand. I don't think you get it. I was a bum. I felt like Paul when he said I was the chief of sinners. You all don't understand. He may have killed Christians on the physical. I was killing them on the spiritual. Killing them, straight murdering them. Taking them out of the church. By stupid ways that I was brought up under. Thinking that that was the truth. I couldn't fight my own way out of a wet paper bag. But I'm trying to tell somebody else that's a lie. I was shine up and show back to them. I pray the Lord give me a chance to cross paths with that brother again. So I'm going to make it right. I'm going to make it right. And I'm going to tell you, the Lord's probably already made the way. Ain't nothing I can do to get in the way of the Lord. But I think about that. And now I know there's therefore now no condemnation. But if it's the hurt that I know, that I've seen and having tasted of this God, what he can do, and the fact of the understanding to think that I might have come in the way of a relationship like this thing that I'm enjoying, that I might have come in the way of that with somebody else in the Lord, that's painful. I don't ever want to do that. But if anything, I only want to show forth his greatness. I only want to show forth his glory in the clearest of ways, so there's clarity that people know when they look at me, ain't nothing about me, but it's the Lord and the Lord only. It's him that's done. Amen? 1 Corinthians 10. We're going to be finishing up. I'm going to let the Lord have his way. In those times, we remember this scripture, 1 Corinthians 10:13.
There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man.
There's nothing that came upon us that was any different than things that come upon other people. That they've already met other people that have already been through this. It's just new to us. It seems grave to us because maybe it's two or three of them that happened at the same time. But if you look at what they really are, man, no alien shit fell out of the heaven and crashed into your house and you're like, this has never happened anymore. What am I going to do now? It's not something uncommon and crazy. But if you really look at your trouble for what it is, it's the same thing that everybody else is going through. Amen? Go ahead.
But God is faithful.
Read that again.
But God is faithful.
The creator of everything that we know. He is God. I can't get that across enough. He's God. He doesn't have to be nothing. He's God. He makes the impossible possible. He's God. He's faithful. He says, nope, I'm coming back for them again. Nope, I'm not going to give you down again. I'm coming back to deliver. I'm coming back to save. I'm coming back to heal. I told them from the beginning that I would be there for them, that I wouldn't leave them, that I wouldn't forsake them. I'm coming back again. I heard their cry. Their distress came out unto my ear. I'm moved with, where are they? I got to go save them again. He's God. Who would hold it to him if one time he just said, man, this is like the 76th time. I'm tired of that voice already. I'm not going to come this one time. Who would be like, excuse me? We need to go sit down and have a talk. We need a court session right now. You go get on the trial stand. Who would be able to do that to him? He's God. Nobody. But it's because he himself is God, and he remembers that he said it. He's like, oh, I'm sticking to what I said. Amen? That's called integrity. That's called love. That's called mercy. And that's called grace. Go ahead.
Who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able.
He knows exactly how to perfect us. He knows exactly what we need at that point in time. And he knows what thing to show us and what thing to keep us blind to. Because truth be told, if he was the game to cover fully, completely out, we might keel over. But there's things he said, no, you ain't ready for that, Dad. It'll kill you. It'll cause you to fall away from me. But my mercy, hallelujah, my mercy deems thus far, you're still perfect. Even though there's these things I haven't shown you about you, you're not ready for them. I haven't shown you, so it's not accountable to you. You're still perfect in my eyes. Lord does that. And nobody but God does that. Read on.
But will the temptation also make a way to escape?
With what? The temptation. temptation and trouble is with that same thing that he brought to perfect us, with that same thing he's going to make a way out. That's crazy. That's amazing. You talk about somebody got caught in a house fire. That's deep trouble. You're caught in a house fire. But with that house fire, you're going to be saved. Well, what's going to happen? How does that work? Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to figure it out. Because when the insurance policy comes back and you've been triple paying on your insurance and you didn't know because the insurance agent gave you the wrong, when they go to see the value of worth, the house that burnt down was a shack, but what you're entitled to is a mansion. And they're going to say, wow, I know you've been paying on it for a long time. You've been paying way more than you're supposed to, but yeah, so this is the payout. The Lord knows how to do what he's doing. Amen. We would never do that because we would say, I ain't paying triple for how many years? No, I'm just giving you regular. I'm going to tell you what I got. And the Lord said, no, I've made you for better. I want to give you more. Let me do what I got to do. Let me bring the trouble that you need and let me make a way out with that trouble because I'm perfecting you. Amen. Go ahead.
That ye may be able to bear it.
Amen. Amen. Romans 8. We got a few more minutes. If the Lord gives me another scripture, we're going to keep going.
Oh, it's mad.
Amen. In verse 28.
And we know that all things work together for the good to them that love God.
And we know. Like before he said, know whom you believe. Know whom you believe. Amen. He's saying, and this as well, know that everything you're going through, in every trial, in every circumstance, in every situation, no matter how bad it looks, no matter who it's involved with, no matter how long it's been there, no matter what, he's saying, know that all things, I don't care what category it's in, I don't care how bad it looks, all things, even when it looks like to everybody and you that it's not going your way, that you got duped in front of the world, and you got played like a sucker, even in those things, they were designed on purpose to be just like the way they are. Why? Because we gave our life to him. Now he's in control. He's routing and rerouting an avenue to bring us closer to him, to make us more like him. He knows how to shave off that little bump. He knows exactly what it takes. And then with that same job, he'll bring you out to another whole plateau, another rung on the ladder you never saw yet. Amen? He's using it power to work together for good to them that love him. If we didn't love him, we would have never chosen him. And surely if we didn't love him, we wouldn't be sitting here right now. So everything we're going through is because we love him and he's working it together for our good. The progression to perfection is taking place. Get excited. Find the biggest trouble that you're in right now and literally start getting giddy. Your presence inside that trouble. Your way out is in that trouble. Literally start getting so excited that you can't stop. Just get, what's wrong with you? I'm so excited right now. I don't know how the Lord's going to do it, but he's going to do it. He's going to make a way. You just keep watching. You might not see me for 6 months, but when you see me, you're going to know the Lord moved on this situation. Keep watching. Stay tuned. Watch God. He's going to do it. Amen? Go ahead.
To them who are called, who are the called, according to his purpose.
He already showed us in the beginning of tonight we were the called. We knew before tonight we were the called. We just got to believe that we're in what we're in for his purpose. We just got to believe that just because it's so bad, it's joy is coming.
That's right.
The man says, man thinks they're so wise. They say, well, every action has an equal and opposite reaction. Well, for 10 pounds of negativity, you get 10 pounds of positivity. What's that mean? The greater the trouble, the more joy is coming.
That's right.
The greater the trouble, the crazier, the thicker that it seems, the more power is on its way for deliverance. The more wisdom is on its way. The more peace is on its way. And will we get sad for that? Will we feel bad for that? The Lord's saying, rejoice and be exceeding glad. Rejoice because the Calvary is on its way. The trumpets of heaven have blown. We've seen distress in the land of the children of the Most High. Help is coming. It's already on the way. His name's Jesus. He's already here. Amen? Your progression to perfection is in full swing. You are exactly where I want you to be. In the thick of your trouble, you're exactly where I've destined you to be. He's just telling us, hold on. Stay excited. Amen? Keep the faith. Stay excited. You know that I'm God and I'm going to do it. I did it before. I'm going to do it again. But why is it getting harder? Because you're getting higher. Why does it seem weightier? Because more is coming. More greatness is on the way. Heaven. There's a call from heaven for the children of God to be perfect. He's getting ready to open that treasure chest. And what he finds in there is what we have allowed him to do with us in this time frame, during this progression to perfection. Amen? Give the Lord some glory.